Maraming salamat, Madam Chair. Just a manifestation. I believe we have extracted enough information from General De La Rosa, and we commend the good general for being a sport, for being patient, and also I commend him for acting on the complaints yesterday. Immediately nirelieve nyo, General, yung mga na-involved na police, at yun yung gusto natin makita, na yung internal discipline mechanisms ng PNP ay working. Now, I would like to hear sana, Madam Chair, from at least one of the witnesses, siguro kahit mga 15 minutes lang, kung uninterrupted na testimony, so that we can hear yes. something new.
Yes, Madam thank Chair. You, Senator Trillanes. Actually, we were informed by the Office of the Senate President that our regular plenary session, which is 3 o'clock, has been moved to 4 o'clock. But we need to wrap up by 3 o'clock. But yes, well, of course, the discussions today have been very, very interesting because of the presentation also of Director General De La Rosa. Kaya medyo nalihis ng konti dun sa pinaka-focus natin, kasi yung focus natin are the killings. So, but hindi naman kasi maiiwasan yung mga tanong na yon at yung mga points na yon, because these are germane, of course, because we're talking here about the drug problem. Kaya lang, nababahiran nga yung integrity ng programa na yan, yung laban na yan, because of the spate of killings. That is the core issue in our inquiry. And Scott, gaya ho ng sinabi ko kahapon, 11 ho dapat ang witnesses namin at nakakadalawa pa lang ho tayo. So I share the sentiment of Senator Trillanes na siguro naman mag-present tayo kahit isa lang para ma-refocus naman yung discussion natin ngayon sa killings, sa EJ case. At mahirap ho yung mga witnesses natin na nakaharap ngayon, na nakabilad sila, although yung point ho kanina, there's no intention at all to sensationalize yung pagtatakip ng mukha nila is just an added security measure, and also because mahirap na nga ho mismo ang humarap dito, so kung i-expose pa ho ang itsura nila, di lalo hong makaka-discourage sa kanila. So we will be presenting one witness today para meron man lang tayong maipresentang witness. But before that, can I ask CHR, para ho we have the right perspective, dahil rinase na rin ho yung issue na yan by one of the senators, I think it was Senator Alan, the issue of extrajudicial killings. Can you tell us exactly ano ang mga diferensya nitong mga terms na ito? These are, of course, human rights terms, legal terms. Extrajudicial killings, extrajudicial killings, extralegal killings, summary executions, summary killings, rub-outs, vigilante killings. Iba-iba ho ba yan? Can you please, in very layman's terms, kung pwede hong mag-Tagalog siguro para mas maintindihan, eto ho bang mga patayan na ito, o mga cases of killings na nakikita natin ngayon, which is the subject matter of this inquiry, killings of drug suspects, are these extrajudicial killings?
Thank you, Madam Chairperson. Importante nga po talaga na linawin kung ano yung sakop ng extrajudicial killings. At ang sigurong pwede nating paghugutan nito ay yung report ng Special Rapporteur on Extrajudicial Killings, si Philip Alston, nung siya ay bumisita dito. May 10 taon ang nakaraan. Ang sabi po ni Philip Alston sa kanyang report ay ang extrajudicial killing ay any killing by government forces as well as the killing by any other groups or individuals which the government failed to investigate, prosecute, and punish when it is in a position to do so. So, yun po yung malawak na sakop ng extrajudicial killing. ang punto de vista kasi ng usaping ito ay yung sitwasyon na nabahagi rin po ng ilan pong mga senador ng impunidad, na meron pong atrocities na nangyayari pero wala tayong remedy na mahanapan po ito ng solusyon na iimbestiga ba ng gusto at yung mga salarin ay natutukoy at ultimately held to account. So yun po yung extrajudicial killings po.
Okay, para lang mas malinaw uli. Dati ho, kapag sinasabing EJK, yung mga biktima normally ay yung mga militant personalities,
aktivista po, mga media, aktivista, environmentalist,
yung mga cause-oriented,
opo,
etc. And that is why yun po ang naging definition namin doon sa AO35.
Yung
sinasabi po ni Senator Cayetano.
May konteksto po kasi yon. Yung AO35 mechanism na tinayo po nung nakaraang administrasyon ay in response to yung situation na marami pong mga kaso ng extrajudicial killings involving journalists, involving human rights defenders, involving environmentalists.
Pakilinaw lang po na yung mga EJ case na yan involving activists, involving journalists, hindi naman po yan nagsimula sa panahon ng Aquino administration.
Hindi po.
In fact, kaya nga pagpasok po ng Aquino administration, naisip po namin na ipalabas yung AO35 na yan, creating a high-level interagency committee chaired by the Secretary of Justice to look into those EJKs.
Opo. Budsod po yun ng mga sitwasyon. Actually, sa bawat monitoring ng CHR, bawat administrasyon since 1986 ay may mga kaso ng extrajudicial killings as broadly defined by the
But historically, the CHR's own records, and that is why it prompted the entry into the Philippines of UN Special Rapporteur Philip Alston. Anong administrasyon since 1986 na nagtala ng pinakamaraming reported EJKs involving activists, militants, labor union leaders, environmentalists, peasant leaders? Ano po administrasyon?
Post-martial law po, kasi marami pong mga naganap na ganito sa panahon ng martial law. Pero post-martial law po,
Kailan po pumunta si UN Special Rapporteur Philip Alston? Anong administrasyon
ten years,
po?
10 years ago po yun. Administrasyon po ni President Gloria Macapagal Arroyo. At yung
would you confirm that since 1986 it's during the Aquino administration na pinakamataas yung kaso ng mga EJKs under that definition that we had under AO35?
Yung administrasyon ni Gloria Arroyo dun po tumingkad itong mga klase ng extrajudicial killings
involving militants, apo, activists, union leaders, peasant leaders, environmentalists, etc. So
right.
Yun po yung concept, yun ang perspective nung AO35. Kasi pagpasok ho ng Aquino administration, marami talagang mga unsolved EJKs of the previous Aquino Arroyo administration, right?
Well, yung pagbuo ng AO35, actually nabuo siya soon after ng Universal Periodic Review,
yes,
ng Pilipinas.
Because the Universal Periodic Review pertained,
yes,
to the previous administration,
the Universal
Arroyo
Periodic
administration.
Review of 2012 covered cases of human rights violations for over the last 5 years. So 2 years of the Aquino administration and 3 years of the Arroyo administration. And in the Universal Periodic Review in Geneva at the UN, meron pong recommendations na kailangan i-address itong sitwasyon na marami pong mga kaso na walang prosecution and convictions.
Yes.
Kaya po tinayo yung AO35 at yung definition po doon ay para ma-fast track at ma-monitor po yung progress ng prosecution of these cases that emerged during
again,
the Arroyo administration.
And again, contemplated within the definition of EJK ay yung kung ang mga biktima ay mga militante, mga aktivista. So wala sa definition ng AO35 yung EJKs involving suspects or the arbitrary killings of suspects. I can tell you as the chairperson of the High Level Interagency Committee created under AO35, talaga hong nuuna, we considered including that in the definition of EJK for purposes of AO35. Pero ang parang naging consensus is hindi na muna ilagay sa concept ng EJK because we need to focus dun sa mga unresolved cases na mga killings of militants, activists, etc. Now, ngayon naman po, I don't know if you agree with me or not, Chair Gascon. What we are seeing now, the killings that we are seeing now, which have become, which I can say it's a phenomenon, is the killing of alleged drug suspects. Yan ang marami natin nakikita ng mga figures. I know that with the, per the PNP presentation, halo-halo na yung statistics niyo po. Di ho ba? Murder, etc. But karamihan, drug suspects. So,
for purposes po, yung sinabi ko pong definition, sakop po yung sang-ayon sa AO35, which is a mechanism for purposes of prioritizing those kinds of cases.
Mm-hmm.
Especially since these were raised at the Universal Periodic Review.
But
pero yung nangyayari po kasalukuyan ay sakop pa rin ng definition ng extrajudicial killings.
Bakit
so
po?
Yung kasalukuyan nangyayari, kung hindi po natin tutugunan, ay magiging bahagi po ng ating record pagpasok natin sa susunod na Universal Periodic Review na gaganapin na po sa susunod na taon, sa Abril 2017. Tatanungin po ito kung bakit hindi po natin natutugunan yung sitwasyon ng pagdami ng napapatay na hindi po natin nalalaman kung anong punot dulo nito. Kaya importante rin sa yugtong ito na harapin yung kasalukuyang pagsubok.
So again, itong ang mga killings na ito ng mga alleged drug suspects properly fall within the definition or concept of extrajudicial killings.
Yes, Karado it po yan. Yes, it does. Okay. The definition I referred to earlier as enunciated by Philip Alston 10 years ago when he came here, while he focused on the attacks on media, human rights defenders, and environmentalists, his definition actually covers the scenario that we are currently facing as well. The key component is that we should show that the state is doing everything it can to prevent this phenomenon from becoming a practice.
Meron pong reports na yung current UN Special Rapporteur is intending to invest to come over and investigate or probe into this killings.
Last week po, dalawa pong Special Rapporteur addressed this issue directly. Yung UN, yung current UN Special Rapporteur on extrajudicial killings, may bagong tao na may bagong mandate, hindi na po si Philip Alston, saka yung current UN Special Rapporteur on the Right to Health.
Tell us, what are the implications?
Well, ang kanilang position ay dapat tugunan natin yung sitwasyon na ito ngayon at kung hindi po, ay lalabas po ito sa mga reports, hindi lang po sa Universal Periodic Review, pero yung iba pang mga international obligations ng Pilipinas. At
so,
sila ngayon ay humihingi ng pagkakataon na bumisita. At in fact, yung UN Special Rapporteur on Extrajudicial Killings, nag-statement na tinatanggap po niya yung paanyaya po na binahagi ni Legal Counsel Panelo na pumunta rito. Pero I understand po ay hindi yata, ang sabi po ng administrasyon ay hindi po to formal na imbitasyon. So, kasalukuyan, the Special Rapporteurs are anticipating a formal invitation to come.
Because they cannot just come over without invitation, correct?
They cannot come over to perform their mandate of doing an observation without the specific invitation of the government. Alternatively po, pwede rin pong gawin ng Estado is magkaroon ng blanket open invitation to all the special rapporteurs on different issues on human rights to come, and that is actually the preferred modality of the UN, although the Philippine government prefers to invite each special rapporteur on a case-by-case basis. Like last year po, bumisita po yung special rapporteur on internally displaced persons, si Chaloka Biani, dahil siya ay naanyayang pumasok.
So they cannot just come in without an official invitation from the government, correct?
They can come
there in. Are also experts which say that what is happening is alarming, and also, well, because, you know, the Philippines is a state signatory to the Rome Statute. Pwede ho bang sabihin sa amin ano yun? Again, in layman's terms, Rome Statute and International Criminal Court. Meron nung kasi mga experts na nag-express na ng concern that what is happening now may invite the entry or the assumption of jurisdiction by the International Criminal Court under the Rome Statute. What can you say to that?
The Philippines is a party to the Rome Statute from 2011. That was when the Philippine government ratified the treaty that established the International Criminal Court. And we are an active participant in the International Criminal Court. In fact, we have elected two Filipinos to the court. One was a senator of this republic, Miriam Defensor Santiago, and then she resigned. And the new Filipino judge to the International Court is Raul Pangalanan.
I'm reminded that we're supposed to wrap up already.
Yes, Puma.
I think the Senate President has... We recognize the presence of the Senate President, so he's reminding us that we're supposed to wrap up already. So ang gusto ko lang ho maintindihan, meron ho bang basehan yung mga ganyong pangamba na kapag patuloy-tuloy ito na mga patayan, it becomes unabated, patuloy-patuloy pa rin, hindi natin nasusolusyonan, hindi natin nahihinto itong sunod, kasi hanggang ngayon, kasi araw-araw nga nadadagdagan yung statistics ni Director General De La Rosa. May basehan ba yung ganong pangamba na we might be inviting or we might be courting the intervention of the International Criminal Court?
Your Honor, failure of the government to address this situation currently prevailing of unexplained extrajudicial killings and providing remedies in terms of prosecution of perpetrators could result in the possibility of the ICC exercising jurisdiction over those matters if we fail to do so. But we must first satisfy what is referred to as the principle of complementarity. Yung principle of complementarity is a provision in the Rome Statutes that requires states to either be unable or unwilling to prosecute these cases, at which point the International Criminal Court could exercise jurisdiction.
At katulad din ho ba yan ng UN Special Rapporteurs, yung binanggit mo kanina, na they cannot just come in, they cannot just intervene without a formal invitation from the government? Or is that something that is a direct assumption of jurisdiction if they find that there is some basis for it?
Meron pong prosesong dadaanan, normally a process rin of consultations exercised by the Office of the Prosecutor of the ICC. Ang pangalan po ng current prosecutor ay si Fatou Besuda.
Does it have a motu proprio jurisdiction?
Meron pong kapasidad ang International Criminal Court
to exercise motu proprio jurisdiction. So hindi po kailangan ng isang reklamo before the ICC can assume jurisdiction?
Hindi po. In fact, the United Nations has mechanisms of monitoring, and the International Criminal Court as well. So they receive information on a regular basis. They would normally conduct consultations. They will actually also provide advisory support for us to address these concerns. And if these concerns are not adequately addressed, then it is possible that the prosecutor will make a recommendation for assumption of jurisdiction.
Kung sakasakali man na humantong, sana hindi naman po. Kaya nga po ginagawa natin ito para tingnan natin kung paano natin matulungan ang administrasyon para mabawasan itong mga sunod-sunod na patayan na ito. Now, kung sakasakali man na pwede nang mag-assume ng jurisdiction yung ICC through its prosecutor, ano ba yung nakikita niyong pwedeng basihan yan or ground for the assumption of jurisdiction by the ICC? Academic discussion lang po. Given the situation now, na 1,000 plus na po yung mga namamatay, ang alam ko, ang requisites po niyan, widespread and systematic attack. on a civilian community. Ilang grounds ang pwede under the ICC?
The International Criminal Court is a criminal court with limited jurisdiction over only four crimes.
And those are?
And those four crimes are war crimes, genocide, aggression, and crimes against humanity.
Sabi po ng mga experts, posible po under crimes against humanity. In your opinion, pwede ho ba yun? Assuming lang na patuloy pa rin po ito. Dumami pa rin ng dumami.
Kung dumami po itong mga nangyayari na extrajudicial killings at hindi po natin ginagawa ang lahat para matugunan ito at magkaroon po ng prosecution and accountability, yung Article 7 ng International Criminal Court provides for the situation of crimes against humanity. At ang condition po nan ay dapat widespread or systematic yung attacks on the civilian population.
May mga settled definition na ba ng kung ano ang widespread, kung ano ang systematic?
Meron po.
Can you tell us again in very simple terms?
Yung usapin po ng widespread, actually hindi po siya nakatala sa bilang, kundi yung kondisyon na hindi po nabibigyan ng sapat na remedy.
So pwede nga maging less than 100 yan, more than 100, yung walang fixed numbers.
No, walang fixed number. Mm. In fact, there have been instances by other international criminal courts that have identified a single act as being sufficient for purposes of crimes against humanity if it is undertaken in relation to a systematic attacks on a civilian population po.
And correct me if I'm wrong. Pag ganyan, importante hong ma-establish na it's a state policy or a state-sanctioned policy?
Yes po, yun po yung ibig sabihin ng term systematic. Na yung pursuit of the acts or the attacks constitute a systematic or policy-oriented approach to, in a sense, commit these acts. Marami pong acts ang pwedeng maging
alam ko po,
crimes
minsan
against
mahirap,
humanity.
Alam ko po, minsan mahirap mag-establish ng element na yan, systematic. Can you cite any case which try to show to us exactly what is the meaning of systematic? Kasi kung ganyan ho, na araw-araw may patayan, systematic na ho ba yan?
Yung prosecutor will be the one that will determine whether these conditions are present. And what they will look at is the totality of what is happening. And
pag sinabi ho kasi natin na state policy, state sanctioned, and even some would say state inspired, these are normally, well, it's difficult to prove, but you know, it's the totality also of the circumstances, the totality of the cases, because you know, most of those that are charged and convicted dati sa mga ibang countries, talaga namang dinedeny yan ng state. Right? No state will ever admit that there is such a policy of killing. Di ho ba? And for that matter, a head of state will not admit that they have that policy of systematic or of killing people. Di ho ba mahirap yun? Kaya nga po, sana po maintindihan kung bakit ginagawa ko po ito. I'm reminding the administration, I'm reminding the government na, you know, yung mga statements na yan, because Police Director General De La Rosa, I'm sorry, but I have to raise this. Kasi nga ho, meron din ho mga statements attributed to you eh. You can always deny if you want to. Pero naririnig ko po to sa radyo o sa TV. For example, meron kayong statement, kung lumaban, patayin. Kung hindi lumaban, palabanin. Ano ho bang ibig sabihin nun? Aren't you encouraging?
Psyops lang yun, Your Honor.
Fix din ho ba yun?
Yes, Your Honor. Tinatakot ko lang po yung mga po, sir.
pwede ho ba nating bawasan yun? Kasi yes, maaaring wala kayong intention na ganun. That's not exactly what you mean, that you're not really inspiring these killers to do that. Pero malay nyo kung yan ang dating sa kanila.
Thank you for reminding me, Your Honor. Bawasan ko na po yun.
Nabawasan?
Bawasan.
Kasi, sabi ko nga, yung dinedeny yan ng mga inaakusahan sa ICC, eh baka that should be used as an evidence against you. That's an admission. A public admission. So I'm trying to help. Mag-ingat lang po tayo para hindi na mi-misinterpret. Maaring yan ang nasa utak nyo, pero hindi na the men on the ground might have a different interpretation of your statements.
Madam Chair,
yes,
kailangan rin po rin
last na po yan. Oh,
yes po. Kailangan rin po rin linawin at liban po sa ating membership sa International Criminal Court, pinasa na rin po ng ating Kongreso ang isang national law. Yung tinatawag na Republic Act 9851. At ito pong 9851 is essentially a law that criminalizes whatever is under the jurisdiction of the International Criminal Court. So yung crimes against humanity is also a crime under Philippine law. And so ang mangyayari po in the course of the ICC assuming jurisdiction is if it will also look to the implementation of this law. If we fail to implement this law and enforce our own laws as we should, then it also becomes another condition for the ICC to possibly exercise jurisdiction.
So mahaba sa pinyan, kailangan nung kasi maintindihan talaga ng ating mga kababayan. And wala na talaga ho tayong oras, so mukhang hindi na ho tayo makaka-present kahit isa lang na testigo. Ako nga po, I was supposed to be the one to wrap up the questioning. Ang dami ko pa hong tanong dapat kay Director General De La Rosa. But for lack of time, no choice but to declare suspension of the hearings. We will issue the appropriate notice. We will still decide kung kailan po ang next. Pero marami pa po, kasi may mga witnesses nga ho natin, karamihan hindi pa na-present. Maraming salamat for your time. And again, I commend you, Director General De La Rosa, dun sa prompt action mo, dun sa kaso kahapon, yung sa Antipolo. Maraming salamat.